the things that we often forget is that when we talk about migrants and people in diaspora, we're not talking only about others. We're not just talking about people who've arrived here recently. We're not talking about the people down the street. We're not talking about the Indian community. We're actually talking about ourselves. Now, what do I mean by that? I think what I'm really trying to work through at the moment is, to what extent do we remember our own history as churches? If I think back, for example, let's go back 2,000 years, leaving aside the stories of migration and so forth in the scriptures, but if we just stay with church history, from the very first kind of 3rd, 4th century, we're seeing what we often describe as the church fathers, but the early leaders of the church. They're being sent off into exile. They're being banished by their rulers, so being outspoken and maybe critical of the local rulers, and so they're exiled. And that story has played out throughout the process of church history. The Huguenots were French Protestants who were eventually expelled from France by the then ruler, the king. Many of those ended up in Great Britain. And one of the things that the British population noticed as those people came into the England, and which they wrote about, we have records of that movement of Huguenots into Britain, is they criticised them for eating foreign food, you know, for being lazy, for being, you know, they were taking English jobs. And this is common criticism currently of migrants wherever they go. And it's part of our own history. At one point, our Protestant forefathers and mothers were part of this move. Calvin's Geneva, there were 17 pastors in Calvin's Geneva. Each of them was a non-Genevan, a non-Swiss. They were all migrant pastors. And the Genevan population criticized Calvin's migrant pastors. Again, they were unreliable tenants. They might suddenly go back to their home country at a moment's whim as God was leading them. And so the landlords hated that sort of very transitory experience. They were criticized for, again, being foreign. So the levels of resentment around migrant Christian leaders and theologians is part of our history. We need to understand that in order to then see that actually this is who we are. Migration has shaped our story. It's not somebody else's story alone, but it's also our story. And I think that then perhaps enables us to better appreciate those who are contemporary migrants and who are living in our midst.
You know, I always go back to the very root of the word, scattered. And scattered in the Bible has two connotations, right? One is that God scattered us because of our sin. It begins from expulsion. Because God is God, God uses that scattering to retrieve his people back to his presence. So it is both a sign of punishment as well as it is a sign of grace. But in the light of Jesus Christ, it clearly became a sign of grace, because that's how the gospel traveled around the world. So for me, diaspora, I think of diaspora and I think of myself and people that are going around the earth. We are just the agents of spreading the gospel. Now, some of us stay intact to the land in which we were born longer than others. But you know what? Even if you stay in the same town, we're talking about 70, 80 years of life in the span of eternity. But even if you stay in one place, you have to remember your the part of Christian identity has to do with this uprootedness, because we're not yet home. You know, I think the greatest mistake that we can make, especially those of us who call our home, you know, who think that who were born into a situation where our home is more affluent and stable, we have to remember that this is not where we live. Is not heaven. It is not the Canaan. It is not the ultimate destiny for our lives. And so when so-called the diaspora people or the migrants move into our neighborhood, they are graceful reminders from God. You know, they awaken us to the fact that we're not supposed to be so attached to this land as if this is it. It is not. It is nothing compared to the reality that is coming. Like Paul said, this is like It's a mere reflection, not even a good reflection a lot of times. So the tension, I think, is healthy. Healthy, I think, yeah. Diaspora reminds us who we are from the core of God's redemptive action.
I would like to suggest a structure, a theology of culture, starting with humans in the image of God and sinners, making the cultures of the world, let's say Arab culture and Filipino culture. And both of these cultures have gifts of God's common grace, because Filipinos and Arabs are both made in the image of God. And so in both cultures, you're going to have patterns of wisdom and beauty and kindness and truth. But also both cultures, because both are made by sinners, both cultures are going to have patterns of exploitation and idolatry. As Christians, we look for and affirm the patterns of beauty and wisdom and kindness, and we judge the patterns of exploitation and idolatry. And if we do this, we don't merely condemn, nor do we merely conform, but rather we seek to creatively transform. This kind of person who can both love their culture and also critique their culture is the resource that is most needed by every country in the world.